was in New York 5 years ago, and Margaret, my partner, said I needed to go see this play. It was called Waiting for Godot, starring John Goodman, Nathan Lane, and Bill Irwin, and John Glover. And I saw the play, and I said, that is an absolutely terrible play. I couldn't stand it. That got me interested in the play. Then I saw it at Stratford with Brian Dennehy, and then I read it, and each time I was with the play, it grew on me. And it grew in its beauty, in its poetry, in its strangeness, and its take on life. Probably the other thing, if you have to relate your knowledge of Beckett with this play. And my first experience with Beckett was Kraft's Last Tape, which I found an amazing play. And that was the first Beckett that I saw. And it was starred Brian Dennehy at Stratford. And here's a play in which only 100 words are stated, or said, in the whole play. So that's really different. And that's what I found in Godot, a very different concept of what a play was all about, and it was wonderment.
Thomas Webb, talk to me. We had a meeting about it, and he was really looking at the play as through this like 1920 vaudeville sort of lens, and he really wanted to put in physical movement and dance, and he saw the play as it was broken down into little skits.
I've wanted to do this for decades, since I was at the experimental theater wing at New York University and was first exposed to it. There were a couple of productions that were being done around New York City, and I've always wanted to do it. So I've just been waiting for the right time. And I especially liked Thomas's approach, which was much different than what most of them.
I must have made a note of it.
But what Saturday? And is it Saturday? Or is it not rather Sunday? Or Monday? Or Friday?
I started studying vaudeville because that's what he wanted to do, and found some pretty interesting things. And then I really started focusing on Beckett's life and then the play itself. And then eventually, took on the role of assistant director. But it wasn't really until I started doing lines with the actors is that when I really got into the play and started really understanding the guts of it.
I hadn't been in a production in a while. Chance and circumstance had not allowed me to participate. And I like, if you're going to spend that amount of time on something, you want to do something classic. Shakespeare's worth it, worth that time investment. Godot is a classic, it's one of the greats, and it's a challenge. I knew what that script was going to be like. I had previewed it. I had never gotten through a production of it without switching it off. I've never seen it on the stage, and I couldn't bear it when I was watching it on YouTube. So I thought, interesting challenge. First, from the standpoint of mentation, would I be able to remember any and all lines? And secondly, those who are cast in the show, would we be able to make it interesting? Something it wasn't, even in the Beckett-directed version of it that I saw on YouTube.
Downson
can't even groan.
Dom, since when?
Have you not done tormenting me with your accursed time? It's abominable! When? One day, is that not enough for you? One day he went dumb. One day I went blind. One day we'll go deaf. One day we were born. One day we shall die. The same day, the same second. Is that not enough for you?
I had read the play in college, I think, and I just really fell for the absurdity of it. I don't think I necessarily got a lot of the references or whatever, but I just, the structure of it and the kind of energy, and it was just like nothing I had ever read before. And then when it came up on our schedule on the calendar, I thought that would be really, that would be a big undertaking, but it would be really fun to be involved with it. And then I thought about the age, and then I got the play out and just to see if it still resonated, and I was sold.
The same lot as usual?
The same, I don't know.
When I think of it, all these years, but for me, where would you be? You'd be nothing more than a little heap of bones at the present minute. No doubt about it.
I didn't reread it before attending auditions. I just sort of went in and thought, well, I kind of remember what happened, and there's not really a role for me anyway. I haven't auditioned in a while. It might be fun. And then I wasn't planning on coming back, and Thomas asked everyone to come back the second night. So I thought that I would. But I really, it was really for more of a experience than I actually never thought that I'd get cast.
Come on. Wipe away his tears. He'll feel less forsaken. Here, give it to me, I'll do it.
Make haste, before he stops.
What did I learn about Samuel Beckett's play? I had read it 20 or 30 times before I started the rehearsals and seen it 5 or 6 times, researched it. I think that the biggest thing I learned was the humanity of Beckett's writing. His ability to bring out the sense of life and of love and how people live their lives while they wait. And every time I see the play, and I see every one of these performances, is a new way to look at every scene, a new way to look at the poetry of the play. And I think that's what I learned the most.
That it's a lot deeper and a lot more interesting than this is the kind of play where if you read it, it's deadly. If you do it, it's awesome. I always thought it was awesome when I saw it, but particularly this production had entertainment value that I hadn't seen in other productions of it before. And it's a process, like anything else. You start out with preconceptions, and then as you get in and work the material and find the meat, it evolves into something completely different.
And my feet hurt constantly. And it doesn't make any difference what shoes I had. They're not going to be right. It doesn't make any difference. First they're too small, then they're too big. I'm the one who understands the mess we're in, and that there is no end to this mess. So I'm constantly trying to get Dee Dee to fess up to the fact that, I mean, don't talk to me about scenery and stuff. I mean, we're stuck. Let's just go. And he won't do it. So there's angst, there's pain, there's confusion. I'm not really good at, there's a lot of emotion. What I am is a raw nerve. I feel everything, he doesn't. He tries to intellectualize everything. Mm-hmm. So it's this constant battle between the two of us where he's upsetting me all the time because he doesn't get it, he refuses to get it.
Mm-hmm.
He's in denial.
Why don't you just go then?
Because
Because I can't. I'm too much of a chicken. I have too much of a connection with him. Mm-hmm. I mean, we started out as partners. We're still partners. And I have a feeling even when we were partners, it was the same type of situation. But at least we were accepted. Mm-hmm. And for one reason or another, we weren't anymore. And that was sort of, that's how we wound up in this mess. I mean, I try occasionally to relate on the same level that he is, but I'm never successful at it. I only have one spot where I come out with something that's, wow, that's sort of profound.
Aphoristic,
thank you. And the rest of the time, I just want to go to sleep. Why doesn't he ever let me sleep? I mean, if I could sleep, I could get away from it, because in my dreams, I'm transported. But he doesn't want to hear anything about my dreams, so he wakes me up all the time.
Dreams take you away from him?
Yeah. It's not necessarily just him, it's from the situation. And it's a real weird relationship with him. I mean, because there are times when, you know, maybe it'd be better if we were apart. Mm-hmm. I mean, I feel better when we're apart. But then when I can't.
It's a loving relationship though, isn't it?
Yes, definitely. But at the same time, I feel like, just like in any other relationship, I feel like he doesn't get it. He doesn't understand. He doesn't understand how uncomfortable I am all the time. And it bugs me.
I learned to wait. I learned to wait to see what my fellow actors were doing. What were they, how were they approaching their characters? And it was a very long waiting process. I mean, we were rehearsing for 3 months, and it really didn't start to flesh itself out until a week or a week and a half before opening. And so we were just basically, whether it was a conscious or subconscious decision, I would have to say subconscious, we were all kind of waiting to see where any of us were going. So it was interesting that the premise of the play was actually one of the foundations of how we structured the play itself.
I have a generalized idea as far as body tone or voice tone and that opening prance and so on. But as far as understanding how I work with everybody else, that's not going to happen until we're all here at one time and are semi-off book, so we can develop the interaction between everybody. Because right now it's so wooden. It's so concreted. There's no fluidity to anything. But that's the nature of this kind of thing. It doesn't start to gel until a week before we go.
Right.
So I really cannot answer any particular questions. I can't give you any answers because I don't know what it's going to be, because we haven't gotten to that point of things yet.
In my role specifically, I learned a lot about being patient. Mostly because I'm on stage about as much as I've been in most shows, which is not all the time, which is fine. But when I'm on stage, it's not about speaking, it's about physicality. And during early rehearsals, when you're doing read-throughs of the play and examining the language of the play, that doesn't leave a lot really to be done, because it was going through the characters who were speaking and then what those actors thought of their lines. And then when we get to my speech, and it was the first couple times that I was really going through it again.
Are you alluding to anything in particular?
To treat a man like that. No, I think that, no, a human being, it is a scandal, a disgrace.
You are severe. What age are you, if that's not a rude question? 60? 70? What age would you say he is?
11.
I am impertinent. Well, I must be getting along.
I knew I liked it coming into it, but even during performances, down to when we got our feet under us, there are moments where, like, I would make connections and think about that theme or that parallel, and it would just keep on unfolding. So, yeah, I would say the motherlode of my so-called, you know, knowledge about the play came through the rehearsal process.
Is it Saturday? Is it not rather Sunday? Or Monday? Or Friday?
It's not possible!
Or Thursday?
What do we do?
If he came here yesterday and we weren't here, you may be certain that he won't come again today.
But you said we were here yesterday.
I may be mistaken. Stop talking for a minute, do you mind?
I learned a lot about life in general just from the play. And the connections that we have as human beings, and those dreams and those desires and emotions. So I learned a lot about how we as human beings, form those connections and the bonds with one another, and how those bonds aren't easily broken. Keep this hand. Keep this hand like it's really Martha's angles. Okay. So you just kind of like have the hand out.
Okay.
You're really tenacious and tight.
About Samuel Beckett, I will say that in my research, I discovered that he was never without a Bible. He was and never without a concordance. I think it's the fact that he was an Irish expatriate. Obviously, he had an Irish Catholic upbringing, a pretty strong Catholic upbringing. And I think the fact that we're right off the bat talking about a discrepancy in the Gospels concerning the two thieves shows us that Beckett didn't, in my opinion, have a little bit of an axe to grind. I think one of the last lines in the play is about Godot coming when Estragon says, and what if he comes? And Vladimir says, we'll be saved. Now, if that isn't a shot across the bow of Christianity waiting for Christ, or I suppose in a deeper sense, human beings, myself included, always looking for a solution to come from outside and come in and fix it for you, instead of you growing up, taking responsibility for your own life and fixing it yourself. That I think that was a couple of the things that I learned about Beckett. What a mind, though. He wrote that play pretty fast. And to just, write it like that is, particularly that speech by Lucky. I'm not quite sure what that is, what kind of stream of consciousness that is, but it's a stream of something. It's, just like in the dining room, I forget the author of that. He was really driving home some truths about this society and human society in general, and I think Beckett really takes it to the core of human existence. What does it mean to be a human being? What does it mean to exist? What does it mean to ask these questions and live with those questions? To live with the quantum enigma.
You to find wherever you're going to pause so that he will automatically run into you, and so therefore it'll give you the momentum to carefully place.
But she doesn't go down yet. There is a couple lines first.
Oh, okay.
But we can change that. But right now we have Lucky center stage, center. You bump into him just like you did and almost knocks over, but not quite. You haven't clutched him. Do you clutch Lucky yet? You don't clutch Lucky yet, do you? Or until after the line?
I've been putting my hand on her shoulder as a means of guidance.
So, your line?
What I thought the play should be at the very beginning was different than when we were ready for opening night. I wanted a play that was different in its context from many of the other Godots that I've seen. I wanted it more fun. I wanted it to relate to silent movies in vaudeville where the humor came out of pathos. I wanted more movement and physicality in the play than many others that I've seen. And I believe that I succeeded there. You know, how do you succeed? I asked Jamaica Weston to be our choreographer. that was a big success. The casting of it, of Joe Kilpatrick as Gogo, and seeing his physicality and his face move and his eyes were key, and that was a success. So each of these went into making, for me, what I wanted to achieve with this play. I think I achieved what I wanted to with a Gatto that, in my view, in some ways is better than I've seen in parts of it that were on Broadway.
Your turn.
Especially when you're doing civic theater or amateur theater, just as you're beginning to really get where you want to go with the character, it's over. I could have done this for another 6 months, and it would continue to evolve, and I would have found out more and more about Estragon as I went along. So I would have liked to have done it longer, just because I don't feel like I was quite there yet.
It's all right. Didi is here. It's all right. It's all over.
I was falling.
It's all over.
I was on top of it.
Don't tell me. Try and walk it off.
That's enough. I'm tired.
You'd rather be stuck there doing nothing?
Yes.
Appease yourself.
Let's go.
We can't.
Why not?
We're waiting for Gatto.
Be still, can't you?
I'm cold.
What do we do?
There's nothing to do.
I can't. Please, Dee Dee.
Always comes at nightfall.
But night doesn't fall.
It changed every night. I captured elements of it. It would be interesting to see where Putzel would have ended up in a month had we gone longer. What would he have evolved into? I captured elements of it. I felt very good about it. I felt not so good about other parts. It was a work in progress. And I think it would have remained a work in progress no matter how long the run of the play would have been.
I woke up one morning as blind as fortune. Sometimes I wonder if I'm not still asleep.
And when was that?
I don't know.
Yes, but no later than yesterday.
Don't question me! The blind have no notion of time. The things of time are hidden from them, too.
Fancy that. I could have swore it was just the opposite.
I'm going. Where are we?
Couldn't tell you.
It isn't by any chance the place known as the Board?
Never heard of it.
Well, what's it like?
Indescribable. It's like nothing. There's nothing.
And I talked with Thomas on a number of occasions, and the character as it was portrayed wasn't what he had in mind and wasn't what I had in mind, but somehow we got somewhere together, and I think that's the nature of like good theatrical collaboration, is that it's not like being handed your walking orders or having to fend for yourself, but there's that middle ground of putting something together that has ideas from both sides and that wouldn't be possible without more than one mind on it.
It is not every day that we are needed. Not personally that we are needed. Others would meet the case equally well, if not better. To all mankind they were addressed, those cries for help still ringing in our ears. But at this place, at this moment of time, all mankind is us, whether we like it or not. Let us do something before it is too late. Let us represent worthily, for once, the foul brood to which a cruel fate has consigned us. What do you say? It is true that when with arms folded, we weigh the pros and cons, we are no less a credit to our species. The tiger bounds to the help of his congener without the least reflection, or else slinks away into the depths of the thickets. But that is not the question. What are we doing here? That is the question. And in this, we are blessed in that we happen to know the answer. Yes, in this immense confusion, one thing alone is certain. We are waiting for God to come.
I think I did succeed in capturing my role. I was really nervous at first. I spent probably the first month and a half of rehearsals. And Thomas knew too that I didn't really know what we were going for, because everyone involved, it seemed like, had this different opinion of Lucky, and they had no problem sharing it with me. And it's a little bit hard to be directed by everybody, and so I wasn't really sure what I wanted to do with the character. But I think at the end of the day and at the end of the performance, I really did capture everything that I wanted to bring to it, based on Thomas's vision. I think that there were so many different ways I could have gone. But based on the vision that Thomas had for the show, I think that I did succeed in capturing the essence of Lucky.
Alas, on, in short, in fine, on! Who can doubt it? For reasons unknown, in a word, I resume, a skull, fading.
The hat!
Concurrently, simultaneously, one is more, for reasons unknown, in spite of the tennis, on! The beard, the flames, the tears, the stone, so blue, so calm, on! Alas, the skull, in Carmara!
The hat!
The labors abandoned, left unfinished, graver still, abode of stones, in a word, I resume, alas, abandoned, unfinished, the skull, in Carmara!
There comes to a point where my responsibility ends and that responsibility goes into the actor. So there's a lot of collaboration involved. So how I feel like I succeeded was that I helped the actor find their character, and from that, then they took it onto themselves, and it's now fully theirs. So like if we were doing some choreography and they kept forgetting a certain movement, or they kept forgetting to do something, then I found that it wasn't necessary. That obviously isn't part of their character, and it's obviously not something their character would normally do. So in that sense, I felt successful in helping them find their character.
A bit of a motivation or something that he's trying to get at that I'm not exactly sure what it is yet.
But you're the dancer.
Yeah.
You're the professional, not him.
Right.
So with your background and knowledge in dance, are there certain movements? Can you show me something?
Yes, that's all example? I can say is refine what you already have.
Thank you, that's what I'd like.
Okay, great. And I'll talk to him by myself and figure out what exactly his vision is, because I'm, you know, so.
Leave it closed.
So the only thing that I can see is that when you are taking steps and that when you are walking, you are so certain of where you're going all the time that your foot movements aren't like this, but they're like heel, toe, like you know exactly where you're going. And now,
That's huge. Mm-hmm. That's huge. That's what I'm looking for as a dancer.
Right.
As a dancer,
She has the background and the knowledge to understand that there are some stage movements, some stagecraft movements, that are recognized whether you are in ballet or modern or Martha Graham or the theater. They are recognized as movements of dominance, submissiveness, etc. She's the one with the knowledge, not me. I want to see what she has to do, and then I can incorporate. Please.
Okay, so what we're doing is just figuring out certain movements, because right now the only thing that I can see that I can do is refine what he is already doing and giving him a motivation to work with that and see if it works and see if it doesn't work.
What you've already done is huge. The heel and toe.
Okay.
The heel and toe. That's, I wouldn't have even thought of that.
Okay.
But that is a mark of authority.
Mm-hmm.
That is a mark. That's what I'm looking for.
Right.
Okay.
And what, so it is helpful to see you move, but from what I've already seen is the heel toe, and also what you're already naturally doing is that you're sticking your chest out. So your shoulders are back and your chest is out, which means you see a lot of people who are very sure of themselves walking around like this. You know, they're very sure of themselves. But it isn't so much as a forward movement as it is the weight is in the back of you. It's almost like you're sitting. It's almost like you're sitting and you're just like watching everything around you happen, and you're just like, yeah, you know, whatever happens, you are on top of it. And that doesn't mean that you necessarily have that much of a bend in your knees, but that helps. That will help you if you choose to do that.
Would it help to have the toes upward like that? Is that a difference? Heel and toe, toes out, as opposed to straight on? Straight on seems almost militaristic, whereas this is more of a strut. Would you agree that that's what you do in theater when in dance?
Yeah, if that feels good, if you find motivation to do that, try both ways. That's all I would say is this is experimenting. You just have to try it. Find if that gives you motivation to do what you need to do, and that's exactly it too. With your hands behind your back.
Okay.
Because that pushes the chest out even more.
Okay.
So here you are. And also think about maybe chin up or chin down, depending how it is. And so that's you. That's possible. That's something that you can work with. Now, when you're working with Lucky, what I saw is this kind of powering over.
Mm-hmm.
And even though I understand where that, I get it, to me, you can try it both ways. To me, when I see someone standing over, it's kind of like you're caring for someone. It's almost like you're caring for them. So think of it that way. Like, I always envision picking up a child, and especially in this sort of a posture where you're compromising your entire spine for something or for someone. So whether that's good or bad, work with that and see what that's like. Because that may be like, oh, that may send the message that you want. That, oh, I care for you, but the tone of voice is like this.
So
and so you have that authority. So
if Lucky is there and I do this, does that send an instinctive message to the audience that I am being dominant, or that I am attempting to succor somebody?
Mm-hmm.
Which one is it? Which one, or trying to?
We'll have to try and see. That's
okay.
The only thing. It's just experimenting, because these are just ideas, and until we put them into motion with that character, and depending on what scene it is and what situation you're dealing with, then we won't know if that is a good way to go or not. You know, maybe you talk to Lucky and you look down. You know, maybe you still maintain that upwardness, but you're looking down at him and talking to him like that. I'm not sure if that's going to get across. And I guess for me, knowing your characters and knowing the motivation to where you're going, that will give the movement. Because if you want to say, in this instance, hey, I care about you, but I'm also dominating you, then this would be a better stance. But, you know, if you're saying, you know, I'm not really caring about Lucky, then, you know, this is a better stance. With maybe moments of,
Because
it depends.
In modern dance, for example, Martha Graham,
mm-hmm.
Martha Graham has certain set motions that convey a specific emotion to the audience by what she's doing. One of them is the clutch.
Yes.
Clutch.
And that's, yes.
And this is hurt. I'm in pain. Something has happened to me. And I'm drawing myself in. I'm drawing in air. And I'm emphasizing that. I'm showing that something has happened.
Exactly. Okay. She's physically making her body feel pain.
Bingo. Yeah,
exactly. And so that is what's giving the motivation for the movement. Is you are physically doing that contraction in that style.
What?
When are you in pain?
In the second act. In the second act, I'm in pain the entire time.
It means life. It means closer than any play I've ever dealt with, the meaning of what it is to live your life. Life happens. Every day we make decisions on our life, and that's what Beckett was working on, to come at how we live our lives every day, day in, day out, with the happiness and the sadness of it. So that's number one. The second thing is, it's about waiting. Perhaps more, it's about waiting to be rescued. And no one's going to rescue you. No one is going to rescue you. You have to rescue yourself. And that's where Gogo and Dee Dee are stuck. Gogo knows this. Gogo knows that he has to do it, but he doesn't have the courage. And Dee Dee doesn't know it and thinks that he has purpose in that. Just like we do. We think we have purpose in doing things in our everyday life, which may or may not have a lot of purpose. So those are the kinds of things that I've come away from this play with.
We spend so much of our lives anticipating, strategizing, manufacturing scenarios as to what we're going to do, and we don't do it. So we spend a huge amount of time planning for something that never comes to fruition. And that's what I took away from the play. Is that what do the characters do? They wait. For what? For the next day. And they manufacture scenarios, they manufacture stratagems, none of which comes to fruition. In our own lives, sometimes they do come to fruition, but for the most part, they don't. We spend an awful lot of energy, an awful lot of tears, an awful lot of sweat over the insignificant.
When Pozzo is leaving at the second act and he's blind and he says, they give birth astride a grave, and then my character echoes that sentiment and sort of pushes that metaphor further, that image. I think that's one of the biggest all-encompassing themes, is that what do you do with a life that's stripped of eventfulness? You either try to go to sleep, die, or make up your own eventfulness. You have to infuse your life with events, and it's taking that moment, like this brief flicker of a life, you know, giving birth right by the grave, and then you stretch it out, and the elasticity of time, and what, in the end, what do you fill all of those moments and hours and days and years with? And it doesn't really matter what it is, as long as you are pursuing something. And so I think that's where I felt like I kind of landed with Vladimir's life philosophy, his outlook, that it was important to him to be doing something. And Estragon always just wanted to be, to like hitting the off switch in more ways than one. And so it's that dichotomy, like, do you just check out, sign out, or hit the snooze button again, or do you rise against the sense of, what is the word? Meaninglessness, and actually accomplish something.
What's there in the bag?
Sen. On.
Don't go yet.
I'm going.
What do you do when you fall far from help?
We wait till we can get up, and then we go on. On.
Wait, before you go, tell him to sing.
Who?
Lucky.
To sing?
Yes. Or recite, or think.
But he is dumb.
Dumb?
Dumb. He can't even groan.
Dumb? Since when?
Have you not done tormenting me with your accursed time? It's abominable! When? One day? Is that not enough for you? One day he went dumb. One day I went blind. One day we'll go deaf. One day we were born. One day we shall die. The same day, the same second. Is that not enough for you?
They give birth astride of a grave. The light gleams an instant, and then it's night once more. On.
who is Gatto? That's my answer. No one knows. No one needs to know. There's a good shot he doesn't exist at all. There is no Gatto. And there doesn't need to be. That's probably the most asked question about this play. Who is Gatto? Or who is Gatto? And Beckett gave the best answer. He says, I don't even know if he exists. And I don't think the actors ever once asked me that question. They were comfortable in waiting for Gatto. And they were comfortable not knowing who Gatto was.
Yeah. The unanswerable and the unattainable. It's the thing we all struggle with our entire lives. It's the question, what is this all about? And there isn't really an answer, which is why he never shows up. If he would have shown up, that would have been the answer. But in our lives, it never shows up. I think right until the very end, you have your questions.
I think I came into the show thinking that Gatto is God, and I still to a certain extent think that is the case because of what I believe and what I feel. But I think it's individual. It's whatever the person sitting in the audience, the person reading the script, the person playing the various roles sees it as. It's something to save them from the monotony of whatever is bringing them sorrow.
Gatto is a fabrication. He's a manifestation. He is a vague concept. It's not a real person. It's more of, it's what Samuel Beckett used to build his play about. Gatto is simply the unformed future around which we attempt to create some kind of framework. It's really not a person. It's not an entity at all. It's a vague notion of what we wish to become and work toward.
I don't know if it so much matters. We talked any number of times about whether or not he actually exists, whether any of the characters exist, or if it's the internal, like the mental landscape of one individual, and you see the aspects of divergent personalities and or facets of personalities or traits, but I don't think it doesn't matter to me who Gatto is. I think it's just hearkening back to that last answer, which is he gives at least one of the characters and sometimes the other character, Gogo and Dee Dee, purpose. So that's, I think, Gatto is purpose.
You mean you're going to ask that question? Who do I think Gatto is? Gatto is nothing, and Gatto is everything.
That's who I think Gatto is. Even after seeing the play and going through it like a billion, gazillion times, I still don't know who Gatto is. And I wouldn't say that I necessarily would want to know who he is, specifically. But I think Gatto encompasses almost anything you could want him to. I don't know. I want to say more, but I could talk forever, I guess. So I think I'll probably just leave it at that.
Do you mind a question right now?
I'll go right ahead.
When you shot the... it seems like you're pulling stills from running footage. Is that right. What you did for the cast and crew?
Oh, sure.
Well? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Does that work out? It seems like it works out really well.
Oh, yeah. It's really the only way, a realistic way, to be able to capture great moments, because a moment is such a fleeting, it's just like minuscule.
Mm-hmm.
And for anybody with a still shot camera to be able to be that quick, it's a virtual impossibility. It's just total luck. But when you're capturing a stream, then you can go through and you can find those moments. I mean, they just jump out at you. And you just go, everything is right. The eyes are right. The lighting is right.
And everybody, like, you can find a good sort of common denominator for everybody.
Sure.
Like, in that sort of group.
Definitely.
Wow. Today is where we're going to talk, you two are going to talk to Jamaica about your characters. And we're going to talk about how you move, what part of you moves, and generally how you're going to move with your bad feet, and how you enter, and how you move around the set, the characteristics of your whole body. So that's what we want us to work on tonight.
This is by far the most difficult play that I've ever directed, and I can't imagine me ever directing a more difficult one. More difficult for the director, more difficult for the actors. I mean, it's really hard for the actors. 87 pages of one-liners with 100 non-sequiturs and poetic rhyming and strange visions of reality. And at the same time working in a very small 16 square foot theater stage where 40% of the audience is on each side of you, and 20% in front of you makes the blocking really hard. So that goes, you know, how you block a play, how you stage it, how you get the actors to be there when they need to be, is really difficult. So much of this play demands that they know their lines in order to bring out the miming and rhyming of this wonderful play. And it's hard for these actors. They have their jobs every day to get their lines and have them available to them. Because it's so easy with the dropping of one word or the changing of one word to move from act one to act two or to skip 10 pages of text. That's my mystery every night I see this play, is which lines will get dropped, which word will be missed, and how they recover from that. From a technical standpoint, I find that intriguing. And each night they do a wonderful job.
When do you want me to do this? It's going to be different every goddamn time. It's going to be different depending upon circumstances. How are you going to give me, how am I going to give you a generic movement on something which is not generic?
Well,
it is dependent upon the circumstances. It is dependent upon context.
Every other play I have done has had some sort of theme. Well, this has a theme as well, but a storyline, a beginning, a middle, and an end. Gatto doesn't. Gatto simply goes on and on and on. Tomorrow, the characters will be replaying what they did today. For instance, my character at one point says, I don't remember having met anybody yesterday. But tomorrow, I won't remember having met anybody today. So don't count on me to enlighten you. And that is what it, that's what has made Godot so problematic for people over the years, critics, audiences, actors, whoever it might be, in that it doesn't have anything you can hang your hat on. It doesn't, like when you're acting the play itself, I can't remember how many times, fortunately this really didn't happen during any of the performances, but during rehearsals, we would be going through a series of, through a particular sequence of lines, and all of a sudden, we'd be in Act Two. And then all of a sudden, we'd be in Act One. And we were all over the place. The continuity isn't there. In a Shakespearean play, there is a chronological order of events. There is no chronological order of events in Godot. To me, it's science fiction. Godot is science fiction. It's one of the only plays for the stage that I know of that is, in essence, speculative fiction or science fiction.
I was asking for, you have about 4 or 5 different characters in this play.
That's right. So which one do you want?
I want the character that you're relating to Lucky on. That's one of your characters. You're not yelling at him. You never yell at him. You never yell at him. For example, you never yell. Right? You don't yell. You do, and it is a lot more than voice. It isn't just your voice. It is a lot more than, it is your whole body that's going to be. Now, yeah, each one is going to be different, but the basic nature of your character and how you, your general posture in relation to Lucky and their domination of Lucky in Act One is one character.
It is the most challenging piece that I've ever been involved with. Just the memorization alone, and then getting a handle on the voice and voices in some cases of the character, and then the interplay between all of the sort of verbal gymnastics. It's its own beast, and I think it's a really poetic one.
Do not say anything unless somebody says line. Whenever they say line, say that line. Don't say who said it or anything, just say that line. They'll ought to know who in fact says it. Okay, so just say that line, okay? And they will ask. Otherwise, don't volunteer.
That's right up there. The material itself, incredibly challenging. The character, awesome. I like it. I've done Drawer Boy, which I really liked a lot. I did Pillow Man, which I really enjoyed. This was another character that I could really sink my teeth into that posed real challenge for me and made me work all that much harder as an actor.
His character's physicality, his head, his face, his non-speaking physicality is the great humor of this play. I mean, there's a lot of other things, but at the heart of it, the controlling of Act One with Pazzo in the center, but what he does when the others are speaking is where a great deal of the humor comes from. Why don't you start the play the way we were talking about? Could we do that, Jamaica, or do you want to do something else? I would like to have him start. The first thing in the play is he has to come on stage and give everyone permission to realize this is comedy.
It's been hard. It's been emotionally draining. It's not, I don't think I've gone out once after a show to have a drink or opening night I did, but other than that I don't think that I've gone out because I want to just go home and curl up in bed and maybe have a cup of tea and watch a movie. I don't even have the energy to read at the end, and it's very exhausting. It's the most exhausting play I've been part of by far, because of the nature, because of the physicality, but mostly because of the subject matter of the play. It's just a lot to take on every night mentally.
What can you expect?
It's not his job.
Excuse me.
That's better.
Excuse me, sir.
What is it, my good man?
You're finished with the. You won't be needing the. You don't. The bone.
You couldn't have waited.
No. He does well to ask.
Do I need the bones? No, personally, I don't need them anymore. But in theory, they go to the carrier. He is therefore the one to ask. Go on. Go on. Don't be afraid. Ask him. He'll tell you.
What would I tell another director? Start early. As early as you can start. Have your actors make a commitment to know their lines. They have to know the lines. Have a Gogo and a Didi that like each other, that get along with each other, and that are friends, so that, because that relationship is key to this production. Listen to your actors. They bring a lot to the stage. They have good suggestions and ideas. Let me give you an example. Tom Zarni said, what if I were to grab the ankle of somebody in the audience? This isn't in the script. And we said, everyone said, nah, that's a good idea. I said, well, we'll try it. Well, it's been a wonderful little addition to the play. It's been a great little humorous incident, and we've got somebody every night to do it, and it's really worked. And Tom Zarni said, I need to have the rope tied around my neck in the second act. That wasn't in the script that way. But it really is the meaning of what's happened to Pazzo is with the rope around his neck, as well as Lucky's. So there were 100 such incidents of how to present a scene or a character at any given moment. And I would tell a director in community theater to solicit information and understanding from your actors and listen to them.
Stay open. Stay open. Develop a strong relationship with the actor that's playing Didi. I think a strong connection between those characters has to be there. The whole idea is they've been together for half a century, so there has to be that relationship, that kind of trust that's there. And have fun. Have fun. I mean, the whole thing is, he's ridiculous, but he's grounded emotionally. And for me, that's the excitement about it, is to be able to bring that across and invest the lines with the emotional content.
Get started early in the process of just chunking out the line load and getting it stored in your brain, because it only, like our rehearsal process just got busier and more dense, and there really wasn't any off time to be working on line memorization. I have a couple different techniques that I've used in the past, and I didn't even get to that. I sometimes make recordings and blank out my section so I can actually have the interplay with the other voices, but there was no time for that. So get off book as soon as you can, and don't, I guess this is more for if somebody was playing it as a, like, who isn't of the age, sort of like I had to make that jump, just to study, to watch as you're going through life, to watch mannerisms and behaviors of somebody that's at that sort of 60, 70, 80 year old level, and start to mimic them, just to pick up that early on as well, so it becomes ingrained rather than sort of a varnish that's added at the end.
Learn your lines faster than I did. This was the most difficult show I have ever been in, without a doubt. It was absolutely brutal trying to learn one's lines, because it was 80 some pages of non sequiturs, one-liners, or single words. And those single words have They occurred so many times during the play that you could jump, like I said a moment ago, from Act 1 to Act 2 seamlessly and with no intention other than, oh, it's the same thing I said before, probably it's the same thing to say again. And so, to anybody doing it again, learn your lines early on and hope that your fellow actors do the same thing. It was brutal right up to the end. I don't know how we pulled it off, to be honest with you, but somehow we did. I guess the fear of those faces staring back at you from the audience is a great inducement to finally get things nailed down. So, just from a viewpoint of character development, you bring your own sense of character, your own sense of, in my case, this is theater of the absurd. Life is absurd. So I tried to bring as much absurdity and humor to it as I could, because I thought that was the essence of this character. Beckett himself said, Pazzo is an interruption of the tedium. And I guess it's my job was to interrupt the tedium. And so I try to make it as over the top as I could. I know a lot of purists wouldn't agree with me, but they aren't the ones up there on stage.
Being in great physical shape is very important for Lucky, and I kind of wish I had tried a little harder early on, because I thought it was going to be easy to carry bags around, and that was hard, because I would get distracted in later rehearsals. Even I would get distracted by the physicality and not be able to put all of the effort to the acting that I wanted to do, because I was distracted with, oh my gosh, I have to hold these bags for another 10 minutes before I can set them down again. And I finally got to a point where it's not really a struggle to hold them anymore, but I wish I'd gotten to that point earlier on. So it's I think it seems silly, but really being in good physical shape, being in good physical shape is important for this role. And being, I said it before, but being patient is also very important, and having a really good relationship with the actor playing Pazzo. My relationship with Tom was so important for me, and if it had been someone I could get along with, I don't know how either of us would have done it.
Let's contradict each other.
Impossible!
You think?
We are in no danger of ever thinking anymore.
Then what are we complaining about?
Oh, thinking is not the worst.
Perhaps not. But at least there's that.
That what?
Well, that's the idea. Let's ask each other questions.
Well, what do you mean, at least there's that?
That much less misery.
True.
Well, if you gave thanks for our mercies.
What is terrible is to have thought.
But did that ever happen to us?
Where are all these corpses from?
These skeletons.
Tell me that.
True.
Must have thought a little.
At the very beginning.
Charnel house! A charnel house!
Well, you don't have to look.
You can't help looking.
True.
Try as one may.
I beg your pardon.
Try as one may.
We should turn resolutely towards nature.
We tried that.
True.
Well, it's not the worst, I know.
What?
To have thought.
Obviously.
But we could have done without it.
Que voulez-vous?
I beg your pardon?
Que voulez-vous?
Yes, que voulez-vous? Exactly.
Well, that wasn't such a bad little canter now, was it?
Yes.
I always take 1 to 10 questions very seriously, because I try to think of what 1 is and what 10 is. But I think this experience as a whole is probably, I said to people along the way that it was the most difficult thing that I've ever had to do, and the most frustrating thing that I've ever had to do, and as far as an experience, I would definitely say it was probably an 8 or a 9. I think the role itself is probably a 7, but the whole experience of this specific production was
very difficult, and I'm happy that I did it, but it was a struggle along the way, and I'm glad that I still have a positive relationship with everyone who is involved. I think I do, at least I hope I do. But it's been fun. It's just been very demanding. So I would say an 8 or a 9 on difficulty as far as life experiences go.
Probably a 9. It's very difficult to convey the material and have the audience. The challenge is to have the audience willing to accept it. So many people come into this, seeing this production, with preconceived ideas that it's going to be beyond me. It doesn't mean anything. Well, it means everything. And being able to get that across to the audience and have them willing to absorb that, that's a tough thing. Because it is notorious for being ridiculous. It's ridiculous. It's the theater of the absurd. Come along with me for a couple hours. We'll have some fun.
Just for me, I would say it's right there at the top, at 10, I would say. It's one thing that becomes apparent is that for Dee Dee and Gogo, but I think Dee Dee even more so, it's almost 2.5 hours of nonstop action and dialogue. And if you play it manic or like really like hyper, that it's just a lot of output, and it's a lot of memorization, and there's movement and, you know, a little bit of choreography, and there's some, you know, singing to muddle your way through, and so yeah, I feel like it's got this grab bag of requirements, and so yeah, it's up there at a 10.
Easily 9, not 10. 10 is undoable, so maybe I should back off to 9. Definitely a 9. It was a bear. It was a bitch. It was just really hard to wrap your head around it. And it was hard to get everybody else wrapped around it as well. But that's what's the magic. That's the magic of theater, that we did get our heads wrapped around it. That the impetus of opening night really caught everybody's attention. Not like we were, well, maybe we were screwing off a little bit. But coming up on the deadline, it really fired us up to pull it together. And you know it's going well, or starts to go well, where you can look in the eyes of your fellow actors and see the next line waiting for you. In other words, it wasn't the, if I can do it with my own eyes, the frantic hunt where the eyeballs flick back and forth, where you can see them scanning their internal memory banks, looking for their next line. And it was finally arrived at, where you could see folks anticipating what they were going to do next. But that was a long time in coming. So a 9.0.
I said,
a running swore.
It's the rope.
It's the rubbing.
It's inevitable.
It's the knot.
It's the chafing.
He's not bad looking.
Did you say so?
A trifle effeminate.
Look at the, oh, slobber.
Oh, it's inevitable.
Slobber.
Perhaps he's a halfwit.
A cretin.
Looks like a goiter.
Nothing's.
He's panting.
It's inevitable.
And his eyes.
What about them?
Goggling out of his head.
Looks at his get last gasp to me.
It's not certain. Ask him a question.
Would that be a good thing?
What are we risking?
Mister?
Louder.
mister.
Leave him in peace. Can't you see he's trying to rest? Basket. Basket. What can you expect? It's not his job. That's better.
Please, sir.
What is it, my good man?
You're finished with the, you won't be needing the bones, sir.
You couldn't have waited? No, no. He does well to ask. Do I need the bones? No, personally, I don't need them anymore. But, in theory, the bones go to the carrier. He is therefore the one to ask. Go on, don't be afraid, ask him. He'll tell you.
Mister, excuse me, mister.
If he's spoken to, pig, reply! Try him again.
Excuse me, mister, you won't be wanting the bones.
Mister. Reply! Do you want them or don't you? They're yours. I don't like it. I've never known him to refuse a bone before. Nice business it would be if he were to fall sick on me. It's a scandal! Are you alluding to anything in particular?
To treat a man like that? I think that... No, a human being? No, it's a scandal!
A disgrace!
You are severe. What age are you? That's not an impolite question. 60? 70? What age would you say he is?
11.
I am impertinent. I must be getting on.
I'd like to express thanks to the 45 people who worked on this play, from the costumers to the choreographer and the set designer and the people that were on book each night, which is a really tough job. I think that this is the most difficult directing job that I've ever done and probably will ever do. And I wanted this to be a production of Godot that was significant. Significant in the interpretation of Beckett, being true to Beckett's words, yet moving it in a way that gives it life and vitality, and also the wonderment of Beckett's words. That was my objective, and that I worked at every day, and that is what I think we achieved. I really feel that this production of Godot is about as good as it can get.
It was magical, and it was a huge learning experience for all of us, and it was a point, I love doing these shows because it was a point where all these people came together, you know, at this certain time for this certain goal, and we all worked really hard to make that happen, and it's just amazing to see it blossom and to see it finally come to fruition. Everything that we, you know, wanted, or everything that we dreamed that this play would get across to people, or whatever it is, whatever did happen, or however we did reach those people or reach those places in ourselves, was exactly what we needed at that time. And so I would just express gratitude for being able to be in that group of people.
I did not know how much work was involved in bringing a play to fruition.
There were so many things that had to go on. It was so much work. And Tom is an intrepid trooper. I mean, I could not do what he does. That I would probably end up killing somebody. As much as he had to deal with people who just continually jammed sticks in his spokes, I would have just ran people over. I just don't have the tolerance for that. And the actors, particularly two actors, Joe Kilpatrick, who I met, an hour before rehearsal many, many times, and went over and over and over and over lines, and exhibited a tremendous work ethic. And then and Tom Zarni, who towards the end was really, really struggling, and then all of a sudden just kabam, within a half a week, went from hardly knowing half the lines to knowing all of them. That is very impressive. And I will say too about Tom is, as the play that I've been able to watch, he has really, really done a number with Potso. I'm really impressed, and every time I've seen it, I've seen something very new and innovative and creative from him on that role. So, but yeah, I'm very impressed with the production team as a whole, and it'd be good if the community, I think, understood that a little bit more. And hopefully maybe the documentary you make will bring that to light, because I don't know if there's really the appreciation for the Old Town Playhouse and the work that goes into it. And people aren't getting paid for this. So for somebody to put in that kind of time and effort and not getting paid, I think says a lot about that person and that system and that production team.
My experience in Waiting for Godot has been very exciting because it was my first studio play and the first time working with adults besides my directors. The way I got involved in this is during the summer, I wasn't acting really because there wasn't much opportunity to, and since no kids had showed up to the audition, one of my old directors, Michelle, had called me and told me to audition for this because she thought I would be good for the part. And so on the audition dates, I came and I just happened to be the one picked rather than the other people. And during the rehearsals, it's been kind of tiring because I've had to stay up much later than I normally do. But I've learned a lot from the other actors. So I'm glad that I got this experience. And I think it will help me a lot when I'm acting.
I was very pleased with the way it turned out, with the sort of direction that the director, Thomas, wanted to take it in. And I thought we accomplished that. I would have liked to have been able to have even more of a relationship with Dee Dee, with Michael, the actor. But I think all in all, we presented a production of this that, for the most part, people found fascinating. There was enough happening, there was enough entertainment value to it, that the depth of the material was able to come through and allowed them to enjoy themselves to the point where it wasn't insurmountable for them. And to me, that's really gratifying.
Just my gratitude for a great support staff, the crew, and like our producer, your input and documentation was great as a resource and just as a record, and like just from Thomas, everybody who was involved, I just felt like everybody went above and beyond. So I say a hearty thank you, because it's not an easy one to sit through multiple times, especially when we're not far from stumbling our way through it, you know, in the dress rehearsals up till then. So for hanging with us, I can't express enough gratitude.
I want to thank Tom Webb for giving me the opportunity to bust my ass over the last 3 months and to work with some great folks up on stage. Yeah, I want to thank them. I want to thank Jamaica for her efforts. I want to thank all the folks behind the scene, Linda, Judy, Karen, sorry if I'm leaving anybody out, Wayne, for your work with the camera. Thank you for documenting all this. It was a great experience. It was very difficult. It was mind-bendingly difficult. And I was worried to begin with. I've often wondered why King Lear, I should do a survey of this. I've often wondered why King Lear is not performed that often. And could it be because the lead character is an elderly individual? And as a result, you know, the mind is not as sharp. Our brains aren't as pink and fluffy as somebody in their 30s and 20s, who, for whom memorizing enormous amounts of dialogue is child's play. And I want to, I am very appreciative of the opportunity to challenge myself to see whether or not I could pull it off, and in the end to do so. So I'm grateful to everybody involved. I'm grateful to the audience for coming out and taking a chance with us. So, yeah, thanks for the folks in Traverse City for coming out and seeing us.
Do you see anything coming?
What?
Do you see anything coming?
No.
Nor I.
You must have had a vision.
What?
You must have had a vision!
Well, there's no need to shout.
Do you? Oh, pardon.
Oh, no, carry on.
No, I interrupted you.
No, you first.
No, after you.
No, on the contrary.
Ceremonious ape.
Punctilious pig.
Finish your phrase, I tell you.
Finish your own.
Moron.
That's the idea. Let's abuse each other.
Moron?
Vermin.
Abortion.
Morpion.
Sewer rat.
Curate.
Creep.
Critic. Now, let's make it up.
Go.